Philippine equities bounced on Thursday, shrugging off ugly GDP data that plunged the economy into a technical recession for the first time since 1991. Even foreign funds net bought Philippine shares yesterday by about ₱500 million. Joining us this morning, HSBC Private Banking's chief market strategist, Fan Chukwan. Hi, Ms. Fan. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
Good morning. So to say that it's been an economically turbulent and a strikingly unique year feels like an understatement. When the economy looks so dreary, why are markets red hot?
Mm-hmm. I think you're now seeing a tug of war in the market. The tug of war is between the severe economic challenge brought by COVID-19 pandemic, but on the other hand, global central banks are creating massive liquidity. So with unprecedented monetary easing, we have unlimited QE in major economies. So this has provided quite a powerful backstop to the financial market. So on the one hand, we continue to see the rapid spread of COVID-19 virus across the world. But on the other hand, the financial market are looking ahead and look beyond the near-term challenge of COVID-19. And more importantly, we see that the leader in this round of global equity rally are mainly the structural growth winners, namely technology, healthcare companies, which actually benefit from the structural change accelerated by the COVID crisis. So this account for this disconnect between the financial market performance and the economic headwinds we are now facing.
Yeah, Chukwan, unfortunately, the Philippine market doesn't have a lot of these healthcare and tech companies to be able to have or enjoy the big rallies other markets have seen.
Yeah. I think for the Philippine equity market, we will likely see more volatility, especially after the shocking release of the Q2 GDP numbers, because that was much worse than market expectation, comparing with the HSBC forecast of a 7% decline of Philippine GDP in Q2. I think that actual downturn in the economy has been more severe than most economists have anticipated. I think the worrying trend is the severe decline in private consumption and fixed investment, because private consumption and fixed investment account for 90% of Philippines' GDP. So we think the Philippine stock market will likely see more headwinds in the coming months, especially with the total confirmed COVID cases in the Philippines have overtaken Indonesia. So with the current daily newly confirmed cases coming in at 4,500, that represents almost 3 times increase from the previous month. So I think the market will focus on the virus containment strategies in the Philippines, because this will hold key for the recovery outlook in 2021.
Mm-hmm. So yesterday's 16.5% drop in GDP for Philippines second quarter growth contraction there, will that warrant a review by HSBC? Because you do have a full year estimate of about a near 4% contraction for the Philippine economy. Will you be reviewing now?
Yeah. I think the Q2 economic data pose a significant downside risk to our full year 2020 GDP forecast at 3.9%. And the government also revised down the official GDP projection to negative 5.5%. So I think we will review our existing forecast, and given the latest reimpositions of lockdown measures in Metro Manila, and given Metro Manila contributes 36% of the economy, so I think the downside risk to our current forecast for 2020 and 2021 are quite real.
Mm-hmm. And for the second half of this year, I know that you hold a mild overweight position on global equities with preference for the U.S. and Asia. Within Asia, you like China and South Korean stocks, as well as Chinese hard currency and local currency bonds. In the Philippines, you are actually neutral. What is the winning strategy now for investors looking at the Philippines?
Yeah, I think positioning in the Philippine market, we still favor quality company which generate sustainable cash flow and resilient earnings. So we have already seen quite a severe contraction in private consumption. But going into 2021, as the development of vaccine and new drugs has been progressing rapidly, so we still see a reasonably positive chance that a vaccine would be available in 2021, probably in the first half of 2021. So this would still set the stage for economic recovery in the regions, including the Philippines. So we still are positioned for a post-COVID recovery in 2021. But for the Philippine economy, we would likely see more challenge given the recent resurgence in COVID infections and all this rollback in reopening measures. So we will likely see a further re-imposition of lockdown measures in the coming weeks as the government would take more stringent control to contain the spread of the virus. So this will result in pretty challenging economic performance in the second half of this year. But from a low base, we think the economic recovery will benefit the private consumption sector because this the key driver for the domestic economy. So we will continue to focus on the domestically driven sector, particularly the consumption companies, real estate companies.
Okay. When you look at real interest rates, they're actually down. When real rates are down, Chukwan, what's the breaking point? And how at that point will asset allocation rotate? Do you go, do you exit equities and invest more in bonds? Do you go for gold? Do you try to hold as much cash as you can right now?
Yeah. As we are positioning for a staggered and uneven U-shaped recovery, but we do expect the recovery will persist going into 2021. So we have a mild overweight on global equities. And as we are now entering a low-yield world for an extended period, and in the U.S., we don't expect policy rates will go up from the current near zero level until the end of 2022. This means that in the next 2.5 years, we will stay in a zero interest rate environment, and this is going to benefit the carry asset. So we expect continual global fund flow into the higher yielding asset class, including emerging market and Asian credit. So in Asia, we continue to see the Asian U.S. dollar bond as pretty attractive yield generator. And we also like the high dividend stock in Asia, including the Asian REIT, as the REIT actually generate quite a stable income for investors who are seeking for yield. It's actually a very challenging environment for investors to generate stable income. So we like the Asian credit market, and we also believe high dividend stock with growth would be pretty attractive yield generator.
Final question, Chukwan. Philippine bonds, used to be Asia's best performing, is losing its allure as real rates turn lower. Bonds returned this year are 17% amid all the rate cuts. Do you think the bond rally is coming to an end?
I think the bond market in the Philippines is now in a consolidation mode because the yield differential has substantially narrowed after the policy rate cut of the BSP, and we expect another 25 basis policy rate cut in the fourth quarter, and with the narrowing of the yield differential, we think the bond market will likely ring trade, but we still see selective carry opportunity in the Philippine bond market, because as compared with the developed market, Philippine bonds still deliver relatively attractive yield pickup as compared with the developed market credit at similar credit rating quality. So I think there are still selective investment opportunities in the Philippine bond market, but we will stick with a bottom-up bond selection approach to pick the better quality one.
Okay, on that note, thank you very much, Chokwan, for joining us this morning.
Thank you.